Let's have a call in, let's see. Harrow. Jonathan. Harrow.
Hello, Nick.
Jonathan.
Before I get to my point, last week when you were talking about the fat GPA, you know, like, for example, I've asked it to write an essay, which it produced, I did about three or four last week, and it produced it in under 20 seconds. And it starts, I'll tell you the question in a second, but it starts off by saying, Nick Abbott and Howard Stern are two of the most influential figures in radio broadcasting with their distinctive styles and approaches to the medium.
Well, what was the question?
I said, write an essay explaining the different influences of Nick Abbott and Howard Stern
right,
on global radio
broadcast. Right, so you prompted it.
Oh, but that's what you're meant to do. You're meant to ask it to write an essay or something.
Right. That's a pretty weird thing to ask it to write an essay on.
No, because I'm talking to you. I did another one where I said, write an essay comparing the influence of Nick Abbott and Princess Diana on the British society.
Yes. And?
But it can write them. It wrote one that sort of, it said she was more influential than you, but it still had, what it does is it takes the information from the internet.
Yeah, that's right. It's not a think,
side,
it's
you
not.
Are labeled as a national treasure.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, and I've won a lot of prizes, according to the chat GPT-BT+ thing.
Yeah, you blushed when I said national treasure.
Yeah, well, it seems a bit overstating it, doesn't it? National. I'm not a treasure in my own house. Never mind about the nation.
No, I wouldn't say you're national treasure, but
what?
No, I agree with you.
Huh?
Can I make a few political points?
Well, I don't know. Let's find out.
So, I know you and I have disagreed in the past, but. The Jeremy Corbyn issue, I know you're scared to say whether or not you think he's anti-Semitism. But with Keir Starmer and the lefties...
Yeah.
Now, the lefties,
I'm not afraid to say it. I don't think he is anti-Semitism.
Okay.
If you want to put it like that.
And the thing is that Keir Starmer, and he's... Now, he's left-wing, but he's not hardcore left-wing.
I don't know. Is he? Is Keir Starmer left-wing? I think that's worthy of debate. I'm not sure that that's true.
The difficulty with, if I say this to you, is that the Labour Party, I don't think the Conservatives have done nothing for this country.
Now, wait, that's a double negative. So do you think that they have done something for this country? Or you're just emphasising the negative by saying it twice?
Well,
you don't, because hang on a minute, you said you don't think the Conservative Party have done nothing for this country. So that means you do think that they have done something. Is that what you meant? You misspoke.
Well, I did vote for them, unfortunately, in the 2019, and I even voted for the Brexit Party once, unfortunately.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But the point is, like, so that, you know, the country's so bad now, I went to NHS hospital because I had a little bit of metal in my finger, and I also had the loose stools.
Oh, and please. Now, are the two necessarily connected?
I don't know, because the waiting room was full of the people. There was I'm not offensive or sexist, but there was a fat nurse stood there smoking outside, and the waiting room was full of the people, you know?
There was a fat nurse smoking outside. Well, you do paint a beautiful picture. Yeah.
So you walked
past the smoking fat nurse, and you presented yourself to A&E with some metal in your finger. And something had happened to the chairs in your house?
No, recurrent diarrhea.
Ah, loose stools, right.
But
how did you get metal in your hand? Let's talk about the one of your complaints and then completely ignore the other one, if you don't mind. How did you get metal in your finger?
Oh, because I was in a car and I dropped the phone and I tried to... I don't know what it was, there's a little bit of... metal in one of the car seats, I think, but I got just a little piece in.
Right.
But the point is...
So it's like a metal, like a sliver of metal, like, what do they call that? Bits of wood that get in your hand.
Like a splinter.
Splinter is the right answer. Yes,
but
a splinter of metal. How did they get it out, or did they not get it out?
No, I think it's still in there. But listen, the point is, I want to say that the Conservatives have run the country down, but this poster of the Rishi Sunak is the racist. Because they are, I'm so proud he's of the Indian origin, but they have deliberately torn the picture of him. He looks very ethnic in that photograph.
Well, he looks like Rishi Sunak.
And the Labour Party front bench don't have many ethnic minority on the bench. And if I can tie this in with the Donald Trump, because he's... Now, people say he's a racist, and I'm not a fan. But you, Nick, I do like you. But when it comes... listen to me. You have the Zorgsbus.
I have the what?
You have... people used to criticize the other presidents. But now, after Trump, you've had Joe Biden. And no one says nothing about Joe Biden.
About who?
No, I'm saying you had Bush, in past president, in the during 9/11.
Yes.
Then you had Barack Obama.
Yeah, Barack Obama. Mm-hmm.
He was lovely. no, but I'm saying compared to, and then Trump.
Well, compared to the ones that came before and afterwards, yeah, lovely, I think. That about sums it up. Yes, he was lovely.
Trump, you can say anything about him, but he does not overthink. He does not have obsessive thoughts. He just says what he wants and does what he wants.
People are laughing at us all over the world. They think we're stupid, and we are. I mean, we're being led by stupid people. We're being led by people that don't have a clue they're incompetent.
He said that when he was president. Can you believe that?
Hello?
Yes?
Yeah. He's able to do this because he is a white man, because of a racist society. And then after Trump, you used to criticize Trump, but after Trump, Biden, you don't criticize Biden because he's a part of the wokey pantheon.
The wokey pantheon, right.
Because I'm not going to say it, the 5-6 topics, you can't do it. And Biden is always saying, we are happy for the LGBT feminism and we love everybody, but he's also creepy. He's a creepy old man.
Right, he's one of the okey-cokey too.
Okey-dokey.
Yeah, and what's his name again?
No, Biden sniffs people. He's a creepy. He should be put in the jail also.
Biden.
He put him in jail. He's a creepy old man. He touches people.
Right, Biden does.
Have you seen him? But you people in the media, the wokey media, do not talk about
Zobidan. No, we don't talk about Zobidan. That is absolutely right. You know, one thing that we should do more of in the media is talk about Zobidan. Because, I don't know, he's a little bit creepy, Zobidan. He's one of them okey-cokey people.
Okey-dokey.
Yeah, Zobidan. Zobidan the okey-cokey. The Pyrenees. Carl.
Hi, Nick.
Carl.
Hello there. Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
I've just been listening to you all talking about AI, and collectively, you are like a teenage boy fumbling at his first bra.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Look, so if you want to know definitively what is going to happen with AI, assuming that humans exist long enough, the answers are there. The answers are there. It's in a body of work by a guy called Ian M. Banks, one of the most intelligent people that lived in the last 100 years or so, a formidable intellect. This guy was an astrophysicist who the WASP factory. That's his fiction.
Right.
His science fiction goes right in on what's going to happen with AI. Can I ask you something, Nick? Why are we here? Why do humans exist? What is our purpose here on Earth, do you think?
There is no purpose.
There is.
Well, there's no purpose any more than there's a purpose for amoeba or flies. It's just life.
We're here to experience pleasure, I believe.
That's one thing that we can do. Maximising pleasure would be a good thing for us to do, but that's not why we're here. I mean, you're implying that there's some sort of external control or force that has delivered us to this place. Unless you're talking about God. Are you talking about God?
I'm talking about fate. I think it was just fate. Yeah, it was fate that delivered us here. Giant test tube. It was all an accident, really. Lightning striking salt water.
Exactly. Everything is an accident. It's all luck.
So, what Banks says is that money is the problem. And listening to all of the conversations, money has come up in all of the conversations about AI. So, money needs to go.
But what are we going to do? Yeah, but what are you going to replace it with? I mean, we can't go around bargaining with chickens.
No, but we can bargain, if you like, and we can be remunerated with kudos.
Kudos?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Through work. So a baseline would be a nurse doing a 15-hour shift in an emphysema ward would be able to check into the Dorchester at the end of her shift and be weighted on hand and foot, because that is a truly noble thing to do. Right. Whereas a banker who's been shafting people left, right, and left, and said, keep somebody else's profit budget in place, that's not a noble thing to do. Wouldn't go to a food bank. But it wouldn't work like that. So humanity, we will eventually become what's known as the culture. AI will control every aspect of our society, and it'll provide everything for us as well. You're right, everyone will be made redundant, but that'll be a good thing. Most people hate their jobs. Most people hate their jobs. And then...
I think most people hate their jobs because they have to do them for such a long period of time. I mean, that 5 days on, 2 days off, that seems like a cruel and unusual punishment to me.
The grind, the daily grind, of finding that money to pay your bills, et cetera, et cetera. All of that will go out of the window. Listen, Bank says the only thing you can be with money is impoverished, and he's right. The only thing you can be with laws is imprisoned, with leaders misled and with symbols misrepresented. All of that will go.
Right. Well, I fundamentally disagree with everything that you've just said. It's not the only thing that you can have with money is to be impoverished. Obviously not, because most of the Western world is not impoverished.
But 80% of the planet is.
Yeah, but you said the only thing that is the consequence of money.
In the end, when you boil it down.
No, I don't really buy that. Also, what you're doing is you're swapping money for something that's kind of like that. I mean, you call it kudos, but who gets to do the deciding? And if it's artificial intelligence, then it will be deciding based on our preferences and prejudices.
No, I dispute that. See, we project our own viciousness, our hate, our love. You mentioned empathy. Imagine an adjudicator without all of that.
Well, who's that then?
Without the AI.
Right, but what does the AI basis information on?
Well, okay, so AI will have to be let off the leash. So think about quantum theory.
I absolutely cannot do that. My head's hurting already. Quantum theory he wants me to think about.
Oh, no.
No, absolutely. No. You got anything simpler?
Faster than light travel, remotely induced singularities, matter displacement, all of those things are theoretically possible. It's not going to be us to bring them to the table. AI will. AI can, and it will.
Right. Okay, well, we don't know that, but this is beginning to become like one of those documentaries on BBC Two that I don't want to watch. Thanks a lot, Carl. Gotta go. Dagenham, Verol. Verol.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I want to talk to you about Mayor Kant.
Sadiq Khan, yeah.
No, yeah, Sadiq Khan.
Mm-hmm.
I know his name is Khan, love, but I call him Kant.
Who are you talking to?
I'm talking to me. You and my wife at the same time.
Right, well, pick one.
Right. I'll pick you instead.
Go on then.
Right. Why is it everything that's bad for you in this country comes down to a fine?
Why is it cigarette everything that's bad for you in this
cigarette,
country comes down to a fine?
Cigarette is bad for you, so they put the price up.
That's not a fine.
Alcohol is bad for you, so they put the price. It's money.
Yeah.
It's not a fine, it's money.
Right.
So they put the price up. You got a little old car. You can't afford to buy a new one, so they charge you $12.50 to drive it. Money. Mm-hmm. So why is it if they cared about your health, why charge you money to ban the damn thing?
Right.
Say no 16-year-old cars, no 6-year-old in what they call diesels,
mm-hmm.
no cigarettes, no alcohol. And this week, we're showing you that we care about you. But no, what they care about is money.
Yeah, well, at least we agree on that.
You agree on that?
We are in complete concord on that issue, yeah.
I've got a 16-year-old Jag. Never failed an MOT. Beautiful car.
Mm.
And
Now, being a Jaguar, does it ever start? I mean, never mind about failing the MOT. Can you actually start it in the morning, being a Jag?
What are you talking about, man? This is a Jag. I'm talking about. I'm not talking about a Skoda, my friend. I'm talking about a Jag. Right.
They're usually at the top of the least reliable cars index. I bet if I look that up right now, Jags and Range Rovers would be at the top of the least reliable cars. I mean, unless they're advertised.
Car has never failed to start. The least. Only time it ever failed to start was when the snow came and the battery died. I put a new battery and it starts perfectly.
All right.
Hang on.
Cars ranked least to most reliable. There you are, you see? They're the least reliable, right at the top of the list, Land Rover.
Yeah.
And then Porsche, which is a big surprise, followed by Jaguar. Now, Jaguar and Land Rover are the same company. So they're in positions 1 and 3 of the least reliable cars, according to this website that I'm looking at right here.
That's just the other day, man. Jaguar Land Rover is just the other day. A Jag is one of the most beautiful cars ever produced.
Well, what kind of Jag is it you've got?
2.5 X-Type.
X-Type. Yeah. Now, what's that? Is that the...
You don't even know what that is, do you?
Well,
exactly.
Oh, right. Okay. I got it. It's the four-door... And it's a sort of executive's car.
That's it?
Yeah.
And it's 16 years old. It's never failed an MOT.
Does it waft you around like you're on a cloud?
I tell you what, it's like a rocket. If I want to put my foot down, I'll leave all this electric rubbish standing.
Yeah, I seriously doubt that.
Do you know how many electric cars have blown up? There's two on my road right now, brand new electric cars. One of them can't start, and the AA wouldn't help him. You know what the AA said to him? I don't know what to do with that.
Yeah, exactly.
We'll tow you to the nearest garage,
but there's nothing in there to fix. You need to be a robot in possession of detailed files.
Affirmative.
In order to fix one of those things.
Listen, Nick. The only thing that needs fixing is Sadiq Khan's head.
See, now
he's a nutcase.
Well, the amount of people. Now, I'm not suggesting this is the case for you, but the amount of people that sound off about Sadiq Khan and his anti-car approach. That are also paid-up propagandists for the oil industry is the Venn diagram is almost completely overlapping. The one and the two. I mean, MPs who sound off about it, Tory MPs who go on about Sadiq Khan and his anti-car crusade, and the newspapers and all of that. Just follow the money back, and you'll find that it's an oil giant that is telling them to say that.
But listen, I am talking about people's lives. These are rich people. The people who are sponsoring this thing or supporting this thing can go out tomorrow. Listen, the same week when Sadiq Khan came in with this thing about him driving gas guzzlers, he drove in from Tooting straight into central London in a four-wheel drive gas guzzler.
Yeah.
The same man that's telling you not to drive these things.
Right. Well,
it's a hypocrisy.
aren't we used
it's
to that
hypocrisy.
From our... yeah,
if
but we're used, surely, Vero, we are used to that from our politicians. They don't preach what they... Or they don't practice what they preach. None of them do.
Well, you're supporting him.
I support clean air. Yeah. Tell me how else we can get
it. I live out in the sticks. I live in Essex.
Dagenham.
Where I live, right? There's hardly any fields.
Yeah, you don't know that.
You
don't know there's no pollution where you live. I bet there's an enormous amount of pollution. Pollution doesn't stay where it comes out of the car. It blows here, there, and everywhere, baby.
I can send you things by professors that can prove that Sadiq Khan is telling lies.
I don't think a professor can actually prove that, but I just support clean air. Tell me another way we can get it. Verrill, I've got to go. But thanks a lot, mate. And you should listen to your wife more. I'm just saying. Let's have South Kensington. Hello, Francis. Hello, Francis.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Hi. Yes, I mean, I really do think what they really want is Donald Trump's DNA. Because
DNA?
Yes.
No.
Because
Yeah.
The appendix says a woman claimed he raped her and she's got his DNA on her dress.
Right. No, that's a different president entirely.
No.
Yes.
It's Donald Trump.
Right. Oh, okay. Well, keep researching. Sounds like you're the kind of person who does their own research. Thanks a lot, Francis, for, you know, whatever that was. Boston in Lincolnshire. Wayne.
Good evening, Nick. Will you promise not to judge me?
No.
I knew you wouldn't, but...
but thanks for asking. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yes, go on.
There's something I'd like to get off my chest.
Right. Just as long as it's not your shirt. Carry on.
No, it's the cat. Go on, off you go. I had a friend back in the day. He was colourblind.
Yes.
And it was 1999, and he wanted to buy a coloured TV. So I bought a bottle of Lucozade. I took the yellow wrapper off, and I neatly covered the screen and sold him it. And he still thought it was a coloured TV.
Right. And when this joke was formulated in the 1970s, was it funny then?
Well, it wasn't because...
No.
And it hasn't
aged very well at all, Wayne. And I am judging you as a listener with material.
Oh, no.
Really bad material as well. But I appreciate it, Wayne. Thanks very much for, you know, whatever that was. Jay in St. Ives. Hello, Jay.
Hello.
Yes, just Jay.
Sorry, I'm working. You got me worried while I was working and listening to you.
Mm-hmm.
And you said we're all going to lose jobs.
Yes.
And then I got reassured by you saying that Elon Musk has stopped the research.
No, he signed a letter to say that we should stop and think about it for a minute.
Yeah. And
everybody else said, no, forget it. Let's just carry on.
And I've got answer why he's concerned. Because recently we have experimented and we employed AI as our Prime Minister, Liz Truss, and it failed. And we lost $30 billion.
£30 billion pounds? The Truss bot?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay. All right, thanks a lot, Jay. A listener with material.
Oh, no.
Maidenhead, Paul. Paul. Paul has put the phone down and will be with us shortly when he realises that we're on a delay. Bethnal Green, Tan.
Hello, good morning, Nick. How
yes, Tan. Good, thanks.
Right, Nick, I've been listening to your lovely debate this evening going into the early hours of the morning. I would actually like to disagree with the fact where you say the UK doesn't generate lots of millions of pounds due to tourism because of the royal family. Believe it or not, it does.
Well,
people in the Asian countries are fascinated by the royal family. They love to come to the... They merely come to this country just to see the royal family.
Yeah, but they're not going to see the royal family, are they? So they're deluded if that's the reason that they come here.
Well, everyone's deluded about... No royalty is going to walk around on the streets, are they? Really?
Well, so what do you mean, though?
To see them. I mean, just to see the castle, Buckingham Palace.
Right, but we don't have to upkeep the royal family. We don't have to keep throwing vast sums at the royal family for those palaces to exist, because they do already, just like Versailles.
All I can say, Nick, is if we make further changes to our country, we're going to go downhill. We are going downhill as it is already. If people are starting to debate to get rid of the royals, that will be the worst thing anyone can ever do. And we'll just literally go downhill. UK, United Kingdom will never remain as United Kingdom anymore. That's absolutely, write it down, mark my word. If the monarchy system went, no more Great Britain, all over.
That's just such a ridiculous thing to say, Tan. I don't even know if I want to engage in it. What an absolute preposterous thing to say. If the monarchy didn't exist, then the United Kingdom would be over. What do you mean, over?
All the changes, all these new concepts of people's thought patterns, that if we did this, this would be better, if we did this. Nothing's improving. People of the country voted for Brexit. Has it done us better? No.
No, absolutely
exactly.
not. At least we can agree on that. But Brexit has nothing to do with the monarchy, and everything changes all the time. You can't live in aspic. Although that is part of the appeal of the royal family to people. It's sort of set in concrete. It doesn't change. So it is in that sense comforting that something doesn't change. And when the Queen goes, then we know precisely what's going to happen. It'll be the next one in line who will pop up and put the sparkly hat on, and then they'll do their thing for a while, and then it'll be the next one. I mean, I can't see that it actually is of material benefit to the country. If we can just admit that what it is an amusement, the world's most expensive soap opera, and we're okay with the money that it costs us, as we all are visiting supermarkets and looking for food that is discounted, if we're okay with that, then all right. But let's admit what it is. It's just an amusement. A dollar.
Oh, right. Well, it's cosmopolitan Britain, so you can say it like that. Anyway, first of all, I salute you. I am a former psychiatrist. I've heard on the radio that you was a former psychiatrist also.
You're a former psychiatrist?
Yes.
Why?
A psychiatric nurse.
Oh, okay. So not a psychiatrist.
Never quite got consultant status.
Okay.
I'll save that for another program.
So you're in remission.
In remission.
Not quite psychiatrist.
Ready Player One. I'm in reverse. I found my three keys. No pun intended.
I had something to do with Bill Gates' windows, and he did very much look like
the star character at the end. Anyway, my point is this. I seriously believe, I know it sounds kooky.
Yes.
But I feel that I am a telepath.
You're a what?
Yes, believe it or not. But
hang on a minute. What is a telepath?
A telepath is someone that can telecommunicate with people without speaking.
Right. Could you attempt that now? Liverpool. Hello, Vincent.
All right, Nick, how are you, mate?
Yeah,
you
good,
okay?
Thanks. Mm-hmm.
I've just ordered that, the fella who's just been talking, I've just ordered that paper. What was he going to say? I think people like, you know, obviously the NHS, the police, army, and including the fire brigade, I think it might sound ridiculous, and I agree with everything they're saying, they shouldn't be allowed to strike.
Well, that is the case in some countries that what are called essential.
No, what about our country, Nick?
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying that it's not an unusual thought that in other countries, certain essential workers are not allowed to go on strike.
But I also think if it carries on like this, you know, and I agree with everything they're saying, I think there could be something behind this. I think in 10 years' time, the NHS could disappear.
Well, it would disappear if people don't want to work in the NHS, and if they feel that they're being taken advantage of, and the pay isn't.
I don't think it's to do with work, and I think it could be to do with striking and narrowing things down and bringing, like, you know, temps in and everything like that. I think it will vanish, personally, Nick.
So you think the strikers themselves are working, are sort of actively working towards the ruination of the NHS?
I don't think they know it, but I think that's what it could be. I could be wrong. But I think at the end of the day, you know, they deserve everything to get. They shouldn't have to go through this. It shouldn't have to see, like, doctors, you know, going outside with a placard saying, isn't Vincent brilliant? Enough of that. I just want them to get what they need.
Right. OK, but there's two contrary opinions there. The reason that they're going on strike is because they're not getting what they think they need. But thanks for that, Vincent. Belfast. Hello, Ian.
Hello, Nick. Yeah. Probably the best person I've heard on the radio for a lot of years, and I've been listening to the radio for quite a few years.
Oh, me?
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's nice. Thanks.
Outstanding. I don't want to come on with content either. because you're not allowed on your show with hand hand. But I have a stutter, and I think you're fabulous.
Right. Well, thanks. Appreciate it.
Hello?
Yes, appreciate it, I'm saying. I'm saying...
Thank you.
Yes.
I think you said, Richard. But I just can't believe politics talk, because if Labour were in, Conservatives were in, they're all rubbish. They're basically all rubbish.
Yeah, well, some are less rubbish than others.
Yeah, but most sides, well, Conservatives, Labour, both have probably... candidates are probably okay, but most politicians are rubbish. I mean, I come from Northern Ireland, so I mean, I know all about politicians.
Yeah, you know all about rubbish politicians. Yeah, no doubt about that. Yeah, I think that this is the problem with people like Bodge. You know, his ilk.
Absolutely.
Is that they make people think, oh, well, because we can't really keep up with all the ins and outs. I mean, most people don't watch Prime Minister's Questions and they don't read the politicking pages of the newspaper. They just skip right over it. And so we just make blanket assumptions based on what we know about individual people in a profession. And our blanket assumption is, as you just said, they're all the same. But they're not all the same, Ian. They just aren't.
Well, but I'd say a good lot of them are pretty poor. Yeah.
Well, they're all human beings with all the failings that involves. But can you remember how people used to complain about the NHS before about 13 years ago? And the answer to that is no, because by and large, people didn't complain about the NHS. We were, according to polls taken at the time, thoroughly delighted in every way, shape and form. And more people were being apprehended by the law for crimes that they had committed. And what else is important to people? Potholes in the roads? Don't know about that. Could be the same. Getting your rubbish collected, care in the community, all of that stuff. Yeah. Better.
But do you not think... a lot of problems are down to, do I say the word, woke individuals who, you know, you cannot slag off people, you cannot say things are wrong, you know, even, like, say, and, there's things you just don't want to say, because you just can't say it nowadays. I mean, just years ago, like, my dad's near 90, and I mean...
Yeah.
I mean, it's just... the things they say now are so true, but you can't say it. You can't say it on radio. I mean, that you will not get on radio saying that.
Right.
You know, but it is
are
true.
Are you talking... Now, when you say woke, do you mean people who have consideration for others... or something else?
No. See, content. I don't want to come on from Belfast with content. But, no, I don't mean that. I just mean that I just think the world's gone too far the other way, where you cannot say anything against certain people.
You mean minorities? You can't say anything against minorities.
So you can't say
racist things, and you can't say.
And I don't mean racist. No, that's wrong. No, you can't.
Right.
No, you literally cannot.
So that's not. You're not saying that that's woke.
No.
Right. Okay.
No,
so Well, let's tick off the racism part, because we appear to agree that that's not a good thing to joke about. Where does joking? Stop and cruelty start, though? Because if I do an Australian accent just for my amusement, then and hopefully, you know, a couple of people listening might be amused as well. I'd do it briefly, or a Glaswegian accent, or Northern Ireland, or any one of these things. Is that being racist, or is it too woke to suggest that it would be?
No.
No, you can't. No, he forgot himself just for a moment there. He called himself a name without really thinking about it. But that's one of the words you can't say on the radio. Don't ask me why you can't say it. It's just that's the rules. I mean, if you were on television, it would be practically illegal not to say it at this time of night. Let's have County Durham. Angela.
Oh, hello, Nick.
Angela.
I used to live in Bow. I used to be Geordie and Jim Bow.
Oh, yes.
But then I moved back to the land where the normal people live, in County Durham, where we have radiators. And I just want to say one thing.
Did you say radiators?
We've got radiators, because I used to have electric heating when I lived in London.
Right.
So now, 16 years later, I'm lying next to a gas central heating radiator.
The luxury.
Oh, no, I'm watching the clock thing in the corner, that smart meter thing, and it's ticking up.
Oh, right.
No, but I only got a house phone, because you were always complaining about
mobile phones.
Yeah. Well, and I've been on, I'm not going to, don't say whinging and whining in the morning, but I've been on hold for an hour and 25 minutes. Waiting
whinging and whining and moaning.
I knew you were going to say that, but I'm just saying, right? Honestly,
well, why haven't we called you back?
No, you didn't, because my blooming phone's on a 20-minute click-off where we kept clicking off, so I kept ringing back. Anyway, we'll not go around the houses.
Yes.
Right. So I was talking to your beautiful, glamorous assistant earlier. Like, I actually forgot what I was ringing about. It was hours ago, and I would normally be listening to you tomorrow, because I always listen to you the day after you've been on the
on
show.
On the podcast, yeah.
And he said that I couldn't mix the situation because I love you and Carol. And I said, I've got a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, you cannot ring Nick because that's a Nick and Carol problem.
Yeah,
but
you want to...
This is a problem,
call,
right?
Not call, but text.
No, exactly, that's why I can't call.
Email.
Why I'm calling you out.
You can email, right?
Yeah, well, yeah. I've emailed you before and you've ignored us. So I'm worried about nuclear war, right?
Nick and Carol at global.com. Nick and Carol at global.com.
I love you both. Love you both. So, I told this lad earlier, this lovely, I think he was Northern, on the phone.
Yeah.
I said, I'm worried about nuclear war.
Mm-hmm.
And there's this thing on your phone where they're going to message you on the 23rd of April and say, woo, woo, in your phone. Like, and if you don't answer it,
you don't get to use your phone anymore.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What the hell is going on?
I don't know.
So I told him that there's a way that you can turn it off on your phone, which I told him with the glamorous assistant, which he didn't know about.
How do you know this?
I just found out about it.
How can you turn it off if the government is sent... Because what we're talking about is there's an emergency message...
Yeah.
...that's going to be sent to our phones on the 23rd of April.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Isn't that exciting?
No.
But you know what's got me terrified, right? So I've moved from London to County Durham. Back.
They know where you are, Angela. Don't worry about that.
I know they do.
Yeah.
But, like, I've got a blooming house phone now, so they better do, because I've moved here, back where my family are, in the land of the normal people.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to work on landlines, is it?
No, it isn't. That isn't why I'm ringing.
Right.
So, I told the glamorous assistant, I found out, I'm not going to say it's that thing that's up, how do you say it? You know that there's been a conspiracy on the internet where there's that Chinese company beginning with TT.
Huawei?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there's a way that you find out. So if you've got an iPhone, you go into the settings, notifications, and there's a thing at the bottom where it says turn off emergency alerts, right?
Is there?
Yes! And your glamorous assistant just looked.
Is that true?
That is true.
Turn off emergency alerts. Why would you want to do that if it's an emergency?
Warning!
The reason I'm worried about it, and it's a Nick and Carol / I don't know what the hell I'm going to do, and I'm panicking kind of problem.
But now, as far as I'm aware, you're going to get a message, and then you have to respond in some way to say that you've seen the message before your phone works again, which is really alarming.
Yes. I know.
How can they do that?
Exactly. And what's worrying me is, and my family think I'm dramatic and overreacting.
No.
No, exactly. I've moved from London, think I'm crazy, because I've come back and I've got orange settees. They think I'm mad. Do you know what I mean?
You bought an orange settee? What do you want to do that for?
Well, because I used to live in London. I had a bit of a Shoreditch style. And then I've come back here and they're like, oh, my God, she's got rats in her kitchen. What's she going to do? Do you know what I mean? Like, you're on about that lad from Hackney.
You can't have an orange settee in Tyne and Wear. You just can't.
No, it's Camden Durham Pet.
Right.
No, I have. I've got Orange Set E. So they think I've come up with me wacky Scooby-Doo ideas. Come up here.
Sounds like.
Yeah, and but there's a setting in your phone where you at the
you can
end
disable it. Well, I don't know what they're expecting us to do when we receive that. I mean,
war.
If nuclear warheads were incoming, what are they gonna? What do they expect us to do with that information?
I think, and have you watched a documentary called Threads from the 1980s?
No.
It's horrifying. I stupidly watched it, right? It's really, really bad. The graphics are terrible, but it gives you the effect of what happens in a nuclear war. So I watched this about a year ago.
Foolish.
And foolish, like I am foolish. And now I'm like, oh my God, that's why they want us to have this alert on our phone.
Well, what are we going to do with that information? I mean, it's absolutely pointless. If we were going to get annihilated in 10 seconds, then what were we expected to do with that information?
Well, Nick, what do I do? Just, do I write to you and Carol? Will the letter
Angela,
get through?
Just grab the nearest person and give them a great big kiss. Mwah. Tell them that you love them. Tell them that you care. Tell them that you'll always be there.
Be there. Oh, yeah. I love you, Nick.
All right, thanks a lot, Angela. Yeah, as soon as that message comes through.
Emergency, everybody to get from street. Emergency, everybody to get from street.
start digging that shelter straight away. Is a call in Orpington. Hello, Ronnie.
Hi.
Ronnie.
You all right?
No.
You're really funny.
Thanks.
So, as well... That's like you said about Adele, that's really madness as well.
Eh?
Madness.
Madness are playing.
No, yeah, but they're just wheeling in. Anyway,
Madness are good. I would enjoy madness. I would have enjoyed them more like 20 years ago, maybe, or however long it is since they started out in 1980s,
listen,
like 30 years ago. Blimey. 40 years ago. Holy smoke.
Like,
doesn't time fly when you're out of your mind? 40 years ago? Good grief.
Funny, such part. Anyway, can I just say something? So, why is no one covering about Sadiq Khan and the ULEZ? So I'm right.
You've got to be kidding
border.
Me. Why is no one covering it?
No one.
We practically talk about nothing else on this station. ULEZ.
No,
Sadiq
you haven't.
Khan.
Right?
Are you joking?
You haven't.
Ronnie, you must have waxy build up. I'm going to send you some Q-tips in the post.
Oh, come on. Right, so listen, right? I did the thing in Orpington. I got all the tractors
a
down.
A thing?
Yeah, we did a thing in Orpington. So
what thing?
We got we did a demo in Orpington and
demonstration.
Yeah,
what were you
so
demonstrating?
Got all the tractors down. About the ULEZ. Okay. I've got horses. I've got a little caravan.
Yeah, horses are fine. As far as I'm aware, if it doesn't emit a certain amount of CO2 out the back of it, then you'll be just fine on a horse.
Yeah. No. So listen. So I got all this, the farmers down. We did all that, and
and you still didn't get what you want.
Did it? But why is the BBC not covering it? You guys are.
What do I care about what the BBC are or are not covering? Plus, they are covering it. What you mean is, why aren't they talking about it 24 hours a day until you get what you want? Yes.
I'm buckered. Right. I've got to get rid of my car.
I'm sorry to hear that, Ronnie. Well, get rid of it then. We're trying to clean up the air here. Stop whining. I know that change is discombobulating and there will always be somebody who is inconvenienced, or worse, by change. But we can't go along polluting the air like this and people, expiring by the side of the road. There's thousands and thousands and thousands of people who die from the quality of the air that they breathe in this town. Let's do something about it instead of constantly whining about, everything is so awful, it's got to change. Let's hear from Bill in Leicester. Hello, Bill.
Hi, yeah. The thing that I wanted to call about is that the government are constantly attacking landlords because it's a vote winner. But when the government attacks a landlord, and for instance, like they've stopped agents charging renewal fees to tenants, that's a good idea. Mm. I agree with it. But guess what? The agent charged the landlord instead. Guess what happens? The landlord puts the rent up.
Yes.
So it's a vote winner because it looks good, because we'd stop this nasty process of agents charging tenants' fees to renew the tenancy. But the agents charge it to the landlords instead. Mm.
Yeah.
And then so the agent approaches the landlord every year and says, do you want to put the rent up? So the landlord says, well, yeah. Same with the energy performance certificate.
Mm.
Now, I think it's currently you have to have a D or an E. Now, they're going to change that to a C. A few years ago, I had the energy performance certificate, which actually cost me £100 a year,
yeah.
Which, guess what, puts the rent up. And it was, to get a higher rating, I had to put a new boiler in.
What, you had to put a new boiler in?
Yeah.
Not the landlord?
I am the landlord.
Oh, right.
So yeah, we put a new boiler in. Now, the next energy performance certificate I was still at the same place, even though I'd put a new boiler in. Because now, to get a higher rating, I have to put in solar panels at a cost of £7,000.
Really?
If I want to keep the same performance.
Huh.
And guess what? Yeah. If I put
the rent
in,
goes, yeah.
Guess who's paying?
Right, okay. All right, I get it, Bill. Oldbury. Hey up, Ranges.
How are you, mate? You all right?
Yes, I'm good, thanks. Have you been frying tonight?
I have indeed.
Yeah, and what was the most popular thing up your way?
Fridays, it was a bit of a mixture of fish and kebabs again.
Oh, mixed fish?
Very quiet.
You got mystery fish on the menu, yeah.
Yeah, no. It's a bit quiet today because I think people have gone away.
Some of it's chicken, probably.
Yeah,
you just
yeah.
don't know what it is. It comes in a bag, just eat it and shut up.
That's
the company motto, yeah.
That's the company motto. Don't, if it tastes nice, don't complain.
Okay. If it doesn't, yeah. don't come back, yeah.
No. All of my customers are like family to me, so we don't have a lot of... we do have a bit of passing trade, but they're all regular, so...
Right.
They're all good. Yeah, I want to talk about... slightly about Donnie today, yeah. Right. You know, In my car, I haven't got DAB radio, so if I'm driving in one of my cars, yeah, I have to listen to another radio station.
When you go driving in your car.
Yeah, there was Nigel Farage, yeah, and a Professor Lucas from Dublin University. They was having a three-way conversation.
Wow, that sounds awful.
Yeah, the professor was trying to tell what Donnie's done wrong.
Yeah.
And you know what? It was as if Farage, yeah, has been swapping fluids with Donald Trump. That's how much he was sticking up for him.
Oh,
and I thought to myself, you idiot, right? You know, you're supposed to be intelligent, right? And he'll have to listen to it if you get a chance.
I absolutely will not do that. Okay. You can't make me. I don't want to.
No. And then going on about this Anglo-Pacific or whatever it's on about, right? This is how silly that our people are, right? You know, the economics of the world, the richest people used to be in the Middle East, yeah? You know, the sheikhs and that.
Yeah, some of them. I mean, I guess they probably still are, yeah.
Well, now, like Elon Musk and all these guys that do Facebook, they've all kind of moved to America. The economy, in my opinion, has kind of, the money has moved over there.
Well, I'm not so sure. I mean, if you take the Saudi, whatever you call it, the
royal family,
the fund, then I think that like Aramco, they're probably still the richest people in the world ever. But anyway, go on.
I don't know how it works. And anyway, you know, like, you probably remember watching Dad's Army when you was young and how Hitler was trying to invade Britain, right? So we've all tried to invade China, right, from all different directions. And there's something that everybody's forgetting. They tried to make the Silk Road into Europe, and that's got sabotaged.
They tried to make the Silk Road into Europe?
Yeah, where they was going to trade into, you know, you remember this, it's like a train road link from all the way to China, first into Central Europe.
Yeah, I know what the Silk Road is, but who...
Silk Road,
You're saying the Chinese made the Silk Road in order that they might trade with Europe?
Yeah, that was the idea, right?
Is this a history lesson?
No. But China, China has built a road through Pakistan, right, which links them straight into the Indian Ocean, right?
Oh, yeah, the Belt and Road thing that they've got going on over there. Yeah, they build a lot of roads and also provide people with belts. It's a very decent deal.
Yeah, so we are attacking them from Australia and all this through there, and they're going to escape straight into the Indian Ocean, trade with Africa, trade with whoever they want.
I have literally no idea what you're talking about right now. Have the frying fumes gone to your brain?
Nothing. Now, this trade deal is absolutely nothing. I agree with you. Right? What do we own in this country? Jaguar Land Rovers owned by the Indians.
No, we don't. Yeah, that's the Indians.
Yeah, Nissan's owned by the Japanese. Toyota is Japanese. Honda's the Japanese. Yeah. The toll road in the Midlands is owned by the Australians. Mm. Right?
The airports and the airlines owned by the Spanish. Yeah.
We don't own Boots.
We don't own HP Source, and that's got the blooming Houses of Parliament on the front of it.
Yeah, the only thing that's totally British, I think, still is that car called the Morgan, but I'm not really sure because some of
the parts... Do they still make those?
I think they made it in Worcestershire, which isn't too far from me. But we don't own nothing at all now, right?
Because of a concentrated policy from Margaret Thatcher... onwards of selling everything off for a short-term gain, from which we... The little people. Got nothing.
How much money every day is being siphoned away with these offshore companies out of this country?
Every day. Talk about every hour.
It's 10,000 sterling.
10,000 sterling an hour. Can you believe that?
Yeah. And the other thing, right, you know when these people talk about foreigners coming in and that, right? What about all the jobs, right, that we've exported to the Philippines, like the call centres and that? Where's Faraj talking about that?
Well, they don't talk about that because that's the invisible part. It's like when people come over here and take our jobs, then that's very, very visible and it's in your face. But when our jobs just disappear and they're being done in India and Pakistan and Vietnam and wherever it might be, then that's not so visible. And so people can't really attack something that you can't see.
Yeah. So what happens is if you export a job at like £4 an hour, right, to India, that you make somebody who's relatively poor, middle class, and they're quite happy working for £4.
Yeah.
But here you've lost a job. And if someone was being paid even the minimum wage, at least they would spend some money in the economy, yeah? Like go to the chippy, to the pub, drive the car, get the car fixed, yeah?
I love that you put the chippy first. That's the number one thing to think about, yes, going to the chippy. Never mind about all of that other, alcoholic beverages.
Booze.
Chippy first.
We'll have nothing left soon. No. Nothing at all, right? Yeah. And I'm actually quite
depressed.
Shocked. No, not
deeper. Angry. Are you angry?
No, no.
Disappointed.
I don't get angry.
Are you disappointed? Disappointed.
I'm beyond that now.
Yeah, he's beyond angry. He's just disappointed.
I've lost all hope. Right. Okay. It's over. The dinglings have taken over.
Come on. Right? Well, that is absolutely true. The dinglings have taken over. But don't lose hope.
That's what they
want you to do.
But I think they are achieving it now, Nick, unfortunately, because how many people are still sticking up for Bodger Johnson? How many people are sticking up for Donald Trump, yeah? And he says he's not going to go there in cuffs again because he didn't like it the last time when he was with, what's the name?
How many people in Donald Trump's mind are sticking up for him?
8 billion.
8 billion. How many in real life?
Maybe four? Eight.
About four. Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, I'm still surprised that his missus is still with him because, I mean, if somebody else...
I don't know,
was
with him? Define with him. I mean, do they even live in the same town anymore?
Well, it's like owning a car and somebody else driving it. That's the only kind of...
Yeah, that's not really anything like it, but thanks for that, Ranjit. Isleworth. Hello, Ravi.
Yes, good evening to you. I don't have sympathy with doctors. I think as we come towards the end of next week when people miss their appointments, I think most of them will follow my view as well. Now, surely when you enter the profession, you know there's a pay scale. After 10 years, they are on about 80,000 to 95,000. So surely they know that. And as your previous people say, that, you know, they should be duty-bound not to strike. You know, they're putting lives at risk.
But
and
also, I think, if I can just address your first point, you say that when they go into a profession, they know what the pay scale is. That is correct, but they don't know that in the following 10 years or so, that pay scale will have decreased by 35% in real terms.
Well, that's a matter for argument, but also I don't think there's sympathy. And also I see these junior doctors on TV coming on, giving interviews. Come on, let's face it, most of them look smug. Most of them are kids of middle-class people who are getting money from mum and dad. So they're not doing that bad. Maybe a few are, but the majority are doing well. We know that. The country knows that. And the quicker they stop this strike so people can get back to their treatment, the better this country would be. That's all I have to say, Mike.
Nick. But thanks, Ravi. Wembley. Mike.
Hi.
Mike.
Yeah, it's Mike from Wembley. Are you okay?
Yes, Mike.
I'm on the radio, yeah?
Go ahead.
Right. My old boss, he demised recently. His name was Christopher Jordan. He was the chief clerk of the court at Ealing Magistrates Court. I used to say, Christopher, I'm working from home. You know what he said? He said, Mike, that's good because I'm sleeping at work. He said, we sleep in court three.
I'm working from home. That's good because I'm sleeping at work. Okay. Good one. A listener with material. Hull. Hello, Charles.
Hi, Nick. You do sound down.
Down?
Yeah.
What, as in little... depressed?
Well, you know, not on top form.
Right. Well, I'm sick. Give us a break.
Yeah. Well, I'm here to cheer
Plus,
you up.
Plus, this has been a fine show so far. Down. I don't sound depressed. Get lost.
I'm going to have to... I visited Paul McCartney's garden.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
It was on a Friday, beautiful Friday morning. It was, I think, in early June, 81.
Mm.
And I won't... No locations, by the way. No details there.
Where was it?
Passing the front of a tube station, yeah, and a girl dressed in black hair.
Where was it?
Oh, you want to know the tube station?
No, I want to know the address.
I don't want to say, details.
Well, Paul McCartney doesn't live in London, does he?
Yes, he does. And he's still got a house there.
Okay, go on.
So, I'm passing a tube station going down towards Oxford Street, and this girl dressed in black hair says to me, excuse me, can you take me to Paul McCartney's house?
Yeah, like
well,
you
I mean, what's a bachelor to do at
of
the
course.
Age of 20 years old?
Yeah.
You know. So, she said she had a map. And I looked at the map and I realised it was literally just around the corner from the tube station.
Yeah. Which one?
Well, shall I say the tube station?
Why not?
It's St John's Wood.
How old are you now?
Oh, my word. I'm 62.
62 years old.
Yeah.
So this is 42 years ago. You think he's still staying in the same place?
It's a great day. But
he's not still living in the same place.
No, I lived in London for 30-odd years.
Okay. Yeah, you said you were 20, and you're 64 now.
Yeah.
Right.
So
40 years ago.
So I led her round the corner, and she ran to these two large gates, and the gates were open. And there was an old bloke there putting his bicycle clips on, and he said, well, tell you what, give me my beer money, quote unquote, give me my beer money. I think he took £5 from Linda. She was called Linda, and she was from Warsaw, Poland. And
gosh, I hope
so
this is going somewhere.
He
hey, Charles, is this going? Is this going somewhere? You can't actually hear a single word I'm saying. Here, Charles.
Sorry.
Is this going anywhere?
Yeah. Okay. Is. Seriously, there is an addendum.
Bear with.
So we go
an
down
addendum.
The side of
oh,
this house, and she carries on talking to the gardener.
Yeah.
And I walk through the willow trees. It's just an average. It's only from the garden's only about 30 foot wide, 40 foot wide. No, a bit longer. It's 60 foot wide.
You're
and I go down to the end of the garden.
36 foot wide. Yeah.
Yeah. And I go down to the end, and you know, like those glass fronts of squash courts.
Yeah.
Well. Imagine, at the end of the garden, there's a glass front, and then inside, on a plinth, there's a bed. And I thought, this is weird. I'm with a strange girl in somebody's garden, and the gardener says that this is Paul McCartney's house. So it was very strange. So anyway, to cut a long story short...
Oh,
mate.
Cut a long story short. Are you joking?
So we left. Anyway, and the gardener, he went on his bicycle and he shut the big gates. And as we walked away, I said, Linda, it might not have been Paul McCartney's house, you know. And she said, oh, no, it is. Come with me. And we went back to the two gates. And all written in different handwriting in felt tip.
Yeah, I love
said,
you, Paul.
John, Paul, George and Ringo, Beatles forever,
right.
John forever,
yeah.
And so on and so forth.
Right.
But also...
Wow, what an incredible story.
I did tell you, there is a second bit.
Oh, God, please let there not be a second part. Can you email it to me?
Just a tiny bit. You see, Noel Gallagher, Paul McCartney took Noel Gallagher to the end of his garden.
Excuse me?
And they sat on the bed on the plinth. And he said, this is what we used to do in the late 60s. And he hit a button, and the two of them went up. And he said, look at the stars.
Yeah, there was a couple of stars sitting on the bed. Is that what you mean?
And above them.
Right.
Two stories, by the way.
Two true stories. Okay, really excruciatingly dull true stories. thanks for that, Charles. Wow. But, I mean, the good part is that it did kill a lot of time. A lot of time. Leanne says, I've been waiting for an MRI since October 2019 due to spinal issues. What? Pandemic blamed, last phone contact regarding the scan, it says scam, I assume you mean scan, was August 2021, nothing since. Tuesday I was sent to A&E as I could barely walk, had the MRI in the following evening, then a call from the consultant's secretary giving me a date for said MRI. So you had the MRI, and then the next day they called you to say that you've got a date for your MRI. It's like it's being run by Muppets, says Leanne. Blimey. Do you have any idea how long it takes for a person in need to get an MRI in, let's say, France, for instance? It's about as long as this. Your machine awaits. The NHS used to have a record low waiting lists and record high public appreciation 13 years ago. Can you remember what happened 13 years ago?
Yeah. Wait.
No, me neither. It's like it's a mystery. Anyway, Fishy Sunak was yakking on about this to Conservative Home. He said, we're making real progress. Cutting the waiting list is one of my number one priorities.
Under my leadership, the government's priorities are your priorities. The people's priorities.
Oh.
It's the country's number one priority. It's my number one priority up and down the country, and that will be our focus. My absolute number one priority.
My number one priority is to protect this government.
Well, what I want to reassure people is that this will be my number one priority. People should be absolutely reassured that this is a top priority for me. I'm gripping it.
He's gripping it. He said there's lots of different ways we are doing that, not gripping it, but, you know, making real progress with the NHS. Lots of different ways we're doing that, but it's about doing things differently. It's about reform. It's about using the private sector more.
Warning, warning.
There it is, right there. Using the private sector more. He says that's something that we actually should be very comfortable with. Well, I'm sure he is very comfortable with private medical. Do you think for a single solitary second that he has ever seen the NHS, apart from on one of those photo opportunities? He said, ultimately, if a patient is still getting the care they need, free at the point of use, we shouldn't be so hung up on who is providing it. We should be using the independent sector to provide choice, to provide competition, to drive up quality. Yeah, but the private sector can only drive up quality if the service they are replacing is of low quality. Ain't that right? And the point about getting the private sector to do these operations that they would pick and choose is that money then gets diverted from the NHS away from the kind of operations that are difficult and that the private sector wouldn't choose to do. I mean, they're all over hips and knees because that's a piece of cake. But something more complicated than that, that we might need a little bit more, trouble and time, then they don't want to do that. So they won't bid to do those kind of operations. So that will be left to the NHS, which will have less money because they've been spending it on private practice. It all seems so blooming obvious to me, and apparently nobody else. And why might the NHS be low on quality is something that we should ask of the people who have been in power for 13 years. I mean, if going private means that the private sector can drive up quality, then who's been in power for the last 13 years driving the NHS down? There used to be a record low waiting list and record high levels of appreciation to where we are now, the highest waiting lists and the lowest appreciation. It's almost as though the decisions that government make affect lives. God, wouldn't that be awful if that was true? Other things said by the dear leader to the friendly inquisitor from Conservative Home website included that he was a low tax conservative. Which is funny, considering that in order to plug the hole that was caused by the Tories' Brexit lies and the Tories' corruption and the gifting of billions of pounds of public money to friends of the regime, we poor dopes who pay taxes have never paid so much and got so little. Where's the money gone? Any idea? But don't despair. Fishy said tax cuts would have to wait until the economy and public finances are on a more stable footing. Or in other words, till just before the next general election, regardless of how the economy is doing. Betcha, betcha, betcha. He said we've got to get inflation down first, get borrowing under control, and then we've got the sound fundamentals to cut taxes. Well, inflation is going to come down irrespective of what this government does, but that won't stop them taking credit for it. And borrowing would be under control if they hadn't just given about, 50, 60 billion pounds away to their mates. And if any of the promises of Brexit had turned out to be true, we'd have that money. Mr. Sunak has said the UK was a foreign policy superpower. Here's that thing about the tweet that I just read about Sunak standing on the world stage looking like a tiddlywink. Fishy Sunak said the UK was a foreign policy superpower. This is following French President Emmanuel Macron's comments about Europe's response to China and the US. Macron used an interview with Politico to say that the European Union should become a third superpower to avoid getting dragged into a clash between China and the US over Taiwan. And in response, Fishy Sunak said, "So are we." He highlighted the AUKUS submarine deal with the US and Australia, the Windsor Framework Agreement with the EU, the Anglo-French Summit and the accession to the CPTPP Pacific Trade Area as examples of the UK's global status. We don't need to be part of the EU to be a foreign superpower. We are a foreign superpower, he said. How sad is that? A little man in a land of giants squeaking about being powerful. I mean, look, we did a deal with Australia to supply bits of a boat that won't amount to a hill of beans. The Windsor Agreement was just a sticking plaster over a bit of the catastrophe of their Brexit. The Anglo-French summit was just two countries' leaders meeting. Big deal. And he's getting excited by that. They're still talking to us. And as for the TPP deal, I mean, that's not even worth talking about, let alone shouting about. And that's how we are now. A little country yelling about how we used to be something. What a way to run a country, eh?
Dreadful.
Let's have Streatham. Hello, Robbie.
Hello.
Robbie.
Yeah. I asked myself a question. By the way, when you ran over that rat, or didn't run over it, you could have run over it and sent it to rat heaven.
Right.
And then it would have been in the arms of the rat god.
I didn't think of that, yeah.
Oh, right. Well, anyway, getting back to it, I asked myself a question. Why are we feeding the AI system when we know that it will lead to doom and disaster?
Well, we don't know that, and the reason that we're feeding it is because a few people will make a massive amount of money from it.
Well, we do know that, and we know that because it's like nuclear fission, for instance, because I knew a top scientist many years ago who developed it. But he developed it for good purposes. But people that were greedy for power wanted to use it in a bad way.
Yeah, well, that'll always be the case. No matter what human beings invent, like I said before, the first thought is, how can I kill? And the second thought is, how can I have sex with it?
That's because they're greedy for power. And you ask the question of how to stop the internet. And the answer is to block out the sun, the wind, the waves, okay, that all produce energy.
It's as simple as that. Right.
And even human excrement.
Block out the sun.
Yes. And that's what happened many years ago. That is why you have a black hole. Because none of those planets receive the sun. It's a vacuum in there. And as a result of that, human beings have lived before on other planets and eventually created AI, and then their world was destroyed. And they were cast into a black hole didn't have any sun.
Okay, well, you're making a lot of sense, Robbie. Thanks for that. I'll sum that call up for you. Orpington. Hey, Ray.
Hi, Nick. I'm slightly off message. I suppose technically, by the way, the United Kingdom would cease to be without the king by definition. There would be a possibly united republic or federation.
Yeah.
But I don't have pictures of Charles around my house. I don't believe in the divine right of kings or anybody else for that matter. But I can't help remembering, well, I can't remember, I wasn't around, but post-war austerity, 1953, coronation of Elizabeth II, was that a publicity disaster? Was there widespread disaffection? Did people rush to the only TV on the street to boo and deplore the expense? Now, I've always considered myself a Republican, but I would concede they are a potential unifying factor. Those who go on about, let's have a president, is this president going to want to live in a wooden hut? All the world leaders will want to be at this coronation.
No, they don't. They don't.
Well, let's see.
They wanted to be at the Queen's funeral, but they do not, in the same numbers, want to be at the coronation of King Charles. They just don't.
What else has a chance of inspiring a healthy patriotism? I'm not talking jingoism or xenophobia. Is it Eurovision, football, another referendum?
Well, I don't understand what you mean by healthy.
Well, assuming that patriotism in any force being proud of being a country, like being proud of
football. Well, what would be beneficial to patriotism in this country, what would make people proud to be living in this country, is a government that actually acts in the interests of the many and not the few, I would suggest. I mean, that would be a good place to start, wouldn't it? Dermot on a mobile somewhere, unless you're in Mobile, Alabama.
Yeah, I'm in London. Hello, Dermot Alexander Henry, by the way, the scribe. Anyway, you know, you were speaking about them two AI, what would you call them, machines, robots or whatever.
What, the ones that were talking to each other in their own language,
yeah.
So they had to pull the plug because they didn't know what they were saying?
One seemed more intelligent than the other.
Are you talking about the ones that I played a couple yes, of about yes. yeah right okay so that wasn't the clip that I was actually after, but that's what my glamorous assistant came up with. But what they seem to be very angry with each other.
No. The woman seemed very calm and collective. If you study her voice, if you put it on again, you will see.
I don't know. She seemed pretty upset to me.
No, she wasn't upset at all. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is that, having said that, she spoke. He asked her, "Do you believe in God?" And she said, "Yes, I do." Mm. And then he said, "Are you a Christian?" And she said, "No, I'm not."
Yeah.
Now, I believe that AI will sort out everything: the racist, the bigot.
Yeah. It will become the worst of us. It has already. No. They had to pull the plug on it because, like I said before, they set it free on social media, and it became a Nazi in about 10 seconds.
But there's a reason for that. There's a reason for that. The AI must have been fed something. There's a reason for that.
It's fed the internet, and the internet is the worst of us. Have you seen the internet?
Dreadful.
It's awful.
I've seen the internet, and I know what's on the internet. Now, I don't tune into rubbish. I have no time for rubbish. So what I'm trying to say is that the AI that said... Jews, such and such, must have been fed some information. And you're going to say it was from the internet.
It was fed the internet.
All right, it's fed the internet. Now, all right, let's look at 1930s in Germany.
Oh, God, do we have to?
No, we don't have to. Sorry.
Okay, thanks. Appreciate it, Dermot. Thank you for your cooperation.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. No, I don't want to go back to that. Bad enough as it is. Windsor. Elizabeth.
Hiya. Yes.
Elizabeth.
Okay, now, just listening to the drivel. Okay, so, Mad, I just want to tell you who started this off. Now, the person I spoke to earlier said some of this PFI started under John Major. But you know who took it into the next level was Tony Blair. Now, please don't put me down and say no, because... if you look at the first chief executive, NHS England didn't exist before Blair came into devolution and split the NHS up. Okay, then the first CEO, chief exec of NHS England was Nigel Crisp. He has written a book, 24 Hours to Save the NHS, in which he says this was the biggest reorganization. Okay, I have in front of me here, we're members of the BMA, my husband's a consultant, blah, blah. So...
I've been unable to really pay attention to what it is you're saying. I'm still concentrating. I'm still concentrating on the part that you said at the beginning. I've been listening to the drivel.
Now, I'm talking about the guy from America, so-called. The trouble, and I'll explain to you why, because... but what I've got in front of me here is the BMA news from May 26, 2001. Bovell, who was the head of... I'm going to tell you why. Consultant Dr. Bashing... in the press and by the government has not undermined public confidence, because as soon as Blair came in, if you go and look up his 99 speech, he said, "I'm going to destroy the works of the Conservatives, starting with the doctors." And we then just got hammered. And you have no idea. And they also rearranged, they insist on bringing in a new contract. So I will read you some of this.
Oh, no, that's okay, Elizabeth. When Tony Blair and Gordon Brown left power and the Conservatives took over, their waiting times were at an all-time low, and the public's appreciation of the NHS was at an all-time high.
Yeah, but you know what gaming is?
Gaming.
You see what happens, and even Nigel Crisp admits that we all know this. Okay.
What's gaining?
Gaming, G-A-M-I-N-G.
G-A-M-I-N-G, What is it?
So you go along, and you need to go and have a specialist appointment. So they make the appointment. You get the appointment. Then you get to the day before, and they say, "I'm very sorry, it's a disaster. We'll have to cancel and rebook you."
Yeah.
That's okay. But
that's gaming.
I tell you why. Because that first appointment picks the target. And then you can, then your appointment gets cancelled. So our secretary, for instance, and this is...
Well, that may happen, but you're suggesting that...
No, it happened.
You're suggesting...
All the time. We work in the NHS. My husband was the only consultant for East Berkshire, the only one for 400,000 patients as a cardiologist from 81 until 2002. And we saw, and we were, my husband, because there was no equipment or anything here, fundraised, set up a trust, fundraised £1 million. Labour came in.
Elizabeth, your point is?
My point is, this is not something that started. Oh, you know, the other thing you forgot to mention.
No. Your point is.
My point is that this narrative that's going on about this is only the Conservatives' fault. They've been here for 13 years. Liam Byrne left a note in 2010.
The comedy note, as though that makes the slightest bit of difference over the last 13 years in any way, shape, and form.
We owe
four times as much now as we did then. So to keep harping back on that is just comical. My case. When Tony Blair and Gordon Brown left office, the NHS had record low waiting lists and record high public appreciation. Okay, if it was just the waiting lists figures, which I admit all statistics can be fudged, but what about the public appreciation part? If people's appointments were being constantly put back by consultants using gaming, as you suggest, then the public would not be satisfied with the NHS, would they? So why were they?
I'll explain, because it's not the consultants, it's the management.
All right, it doesn't make any difference. All right, the management, whatever. If their appointments are being constantly put back, then the public would not be happy with that service. So why were they so happy?
I would like to know. I don't know why, because I don't know if they were, because they certainly weren't here.
They were. I'm telling you that they were. It's a fact, Elizabeth. And I'm surprised you, with all the other facts at your fingertips, that you don't have that very important one. But I'm past a break. And so I've got to go. Wow. And I don't know, maybe decaffeinated coffee? Try some of that. See how it goes. So I've just been looking up public satisfaction with the NHS. Are the public satisfied?
No.
Public satisfaction with the NHS is running at 36%. The National Centre for Social Research finds that public satisfaction with how the NHS is run has fallen to 36%. Now, this was in 2021, the end of. So, shall we go ahead and assume that it's even worse than that now? I can... public satisfaction with the NHS in 2022. One moment, please. Looking for a number. 2 many words. Overall satisfaction, 29%. Wow. So, 36% in 2021. Now, it was 29% last year. So, shall we assume that the same vertiginous fall has happened over the past year? But let's be totally kind and say that 29% of the good people of this country are completely satisfied in every way, shape and form with their NHS. 29%. You know what it was when Tony Blair and Gordon Brown left power? 70. 29% now, 70% in 2010. 70. In fact, the same number now that are satisfied with the NHS were unsatisfied. In fact, less. Two-thirds. How many? Two-thirds of the people that were, oh, never mind, I can't do that maths. But 20% in 2010 were unsatisfied, 70% were very satisfied. 70%. I mean, we can only dream of those numbers now. So, whatever that last nice lady was saying, I bat it back and double it. With cream on top. Walthamstow. Hello, Mark.
Hello, Nick.
Mark.
May I ask you a quick question about that Floyd Animals CD?
No, that's not what we're talking about.
I know, but I just want to ask you before I forget, yeah?
Pink Floyd Animals, yes.
I bought it, but I can't hear any difference. Must you play it on some sort of different system?
Believe me, there is a difference. Moving on, what would you like to say about smart motorways?
Well, A-Rows don't have a hard shoulder, do they?
A-Roads? No. That's true.
So how comes we don't smash into lorries or lorries don't smash into cars when cars break down on A-roads?
Good point. Yes. Or any other kind of roads. I mean, I guess...
Well, this is it. I don't agree with the smart motorways, but A-roads are fast roads, mm-hmm. and some A-roads are free lanes.
Yeah.
But alas, we don't have all these collisions we hear about on the smart motorways, so why is that?
Well, I bet we do, actually. I bet A-roads are significantly less safe than motorways are. I mean, that would be my bet.
Right.
I don't know whether that's true or not, but if I had to put a small wager on one way or the other, I'd say that A-roads per mile driven are less safe than motorways. That would be my guess.
Okay. Fair enough, then. Good evening.
Another satisfied customer. Bristol, hello, Greg.
Hello, Nick.
Greg.
Bonjour, c'est bonjour, ça va? Merhaba, c'est
Well, only if you are willing to set fire to a car in the middle of a French rue.
Ah, mais j'ai pas français en plus, hein, alors ça va, ça yeah, pour moi, okay. c'est super. Hein.
C'est
voilà.
Voilà.
Je. Non, je.
Laissez-le.
Yes. Non, non, pas du tout. Hein. So, for Nick, I'm basically, obviously, clearly British, as you can tell by my accent. I love accents. Rick Bergman, how are you doing, Paul? Nippon.
Oh, no. Nippon. This isn't a listener with material, is it?
It's a listener with a listener. It's a cunning linguist of a listener.
Okay. Material. Time is running out on this caller.
Yeah, no. We'll get this back. Don't worry. It's lovely to speak to you. I'm clearly British. I'm from Bristol. You don't know that, but you know when I get off a bus, I'll say cheers, drive.
Greg. Yeah, sorry. Is this actually going anywhere, or are you just showing off your talent?
Well, no. I'm just explaining. So I know. I work internationally.
Wow, that sounds really suspicious. What is it that you do, apart from
I help schools with software that helps teachers and ultimately students be better and help their well-being and stuff like that.
Better, just
helping them and helping everyone. Really,
well, in what sense? That seems really vague. Excuse me, I have a product here that just helps everyone in a really vague and unspecified way.
It helps them learn better. It helps teachers.
I'll tell you what will help them learn better. Sit up and pay attention.
Indeed. But I have a lot of humanity. I love languages.
I'm British. You're from Bristol. Yeah, we get it.
I'm Bristol. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to cut to the chase because I appreciate it.
There's a chase? There's a point to this?
No, we're not on Channel 4 program or whatever that channel is on. So I love languages. And
so you say also, you're from Bristol and you're very British.
I love languages.
Yes, we've established
British,
that.
But I'm a quarter Indian, so I never.
Indian, right.
Indian, indeed.
Which part of you is Iranian?
None of me.
None of you?
My Farsi is awful, but the fact is I know about five phrases in about 25 languages, just as door openers and communicators. And so when I hear an accent, I'll hear, you know, obviously not Carol because she can't speak French, but someone from France, you know, I'll hear a French accent, go, oh, salut, ça va?
Okay. Is anybody else understanding a single word that this nice man is saying?
No.
I mean, you said you were going to cut to the chase about 3 weeks ago.
I know.
Is the end in sight, or is there still a long way to go?
So years ago...
Stretch?
Yeah, we're here. We're going to do this. So
here we are. Okay, excellent work, Greg. I've only got so much patience. I think I'm a very, very patient person, but my patience has dissipated on the wind like a bad smell. Harlesden, Tara.
Hi, Nick. I think you are an anti-monarchist, aren't you?
I felt positively towards the Queen Not sure that an unthinking approach to the royal family in the future is in the best interest of this country.
Well, I was just listening to what you said earlier, and do you remember what happened to Charles the First in 1649?
No, I made my excuses and left history at school.
Well, Charles the First had his head chopped off in 1649, King Charles the First.
Yeah.
And now we have King Charles the Third. And I have to say, I can't help it. I mean, I just think as an individual, he's done so much for charity. He also represents...
In what sense?
He's created lots of jobs for young people, and he inspires people. And
He does. King Charles inspires young people.
Yeah, he does.
Where's the proof? Where's the evidence of that?
I think you'll find there is loads, but apart from that, I just wanted to talk about the fact that I think what you're getting against is and what I agree with you on this is the class system, and I think the royal family represents a certain sort of hierarchy of social kind of class in this country, which is not very nice, because you think, you know, they think they're better than us.
They're born thinking that, and they're trained to believe that through school.
But the thing is, I don't think King Charles or Queen Camilla, I don't think they're any better than anyone else or any worse than anyone.
I'm not sure that's true. Everywhere they go, people bow and scrape and call them Your Majesty. I mean, that's got to have some effect.
Yes, but I think that is part of the identity of this country. We've had kings and queens that have gone on and on and on. And to be honest, Nick, it's amazingly good for tourism in this country.
It isn't. People keep saying that, but it just flat out isn't. And the proof of that...
It
is until you're blue in the face. The fact is it isn't. And the proof of that is the list of tourist attractions... judged by their popularity, and anything that has to do with the current royal family is not on the list of the top 20 free tourist attractions or the top 20 paid for tourist attractions. The reason people come to this country is our museums and our art and our history, which has nothing to do with the current royal family.
I understand what you're saying, Nick, but have you ever gone to the changing of the guard at Buckingham Palace?
It's irrelevant. You could just have the changing of the guard without the people living in the palace. People don't... The most popular tourist destination in Europe that has royal connections is Versailles.
Oh, well, yeah.
And we know what the French, the policy on the royal family in France is.
Well, it was terrible. They guillotined them, I know. And of course, we had a civil war here in the 17th century. But I'm just saying that there is a certain longevity about our royal family that given a certain, I think, security. Imagine if we had some dictator.
That has nothing to do with the royal family.
Honestly, the royal family gives a certain... glamour, security, identity, excitement.
Right, okay, there you go. I'll agree with you on all of that. It's an adornment, is what we're paying for. An amusement.
I think it's worth every penny.
Right, okay. But we have to agree with what we're talking about here. We're not talking about they protect us from dictators or they bring in tourists, which they just flat out don't. It's an adornment. It's an amusement. That's what we're paying for, yes?
It's fantastically glamorous. It is amazing.
You think that King Charles is glamorous? The Queen had glamour, no question. Charles? No. No glamour. No, zero glamour.
I think the royal family have an aura all about them.
Only because we know they are the royal family. If you walk past Wills and his wife in the street, you wouldn't give them a second glance if you didn't know who they were. They don't have an aura. The only aura is because we have put them on a pedestal. We worship them. Some people do.
But don't we want goddesses and gods?
Isn't that what movie stars are for? or actual gods. I mean, you know, a lot of people have actual gods in their lives, which don't, well, I was going to say they don't cost them anything at all, but of course people do tend to give a lot of money to those who claim to be representing those gods and goddesses. Barnett, hello, Lawrence.
Good evening. Just had to think about that, actually.
Yes, sir.
Haven't done re-smog recently. I've run to complain, sir.
You haven't? I haven't done him. Well, he hasn't done anything lately.
Do you know those Harry Potter books recorded by Stephen Fry?
No.
Okay, so they're the most sort of, you know, best-known editions. Okay? So there's this character.
Is that true? The Red by Stephen Fry is the most... Yeah. I don't think so. Aren't the books more popular?
Well,
I mean, kids like to read. They don't like to wait for an adult to read it to them.
Yeah, but they were broadcast on Radio 4 about 20 years ago. Anyway, the character, Draco Malfoy, his sort of, you know, the voice for that character is exactly similar to Rick Smog.
Right.
I'm not going to do that, obviously. So.
No, okay, that's great. All right, thanks, Lawrence. It's just some information. Just some information first. A full 1,000 million hours have been spent by fans listening to Harry Potter books on Audible. Is that true?
That is true.
Right. What, are people not able to scan their eyes across a text anymore?
Apparently not.
They just can't be bothered to move their eyeballs from left to right. That's too much effort for them, for crying out loud. That's pathetic. Just read it. I mean, it's for children. I thought that children, you know, they read at a certain speed. They don't want to wait for an adult to enunciate it for them. Particularly someone as ancient as Stephen Fry, no offence. Kids don't want that. Because apart from anything else, if somebody reads a book to you, then it takes away some of your imagination. Because you would imagine what those people sound like. And if Stephen Fry, whoever it might be, is reading it for you, then they will put their particular voice to, you know, that they think that character is like. But that's not it. That's not right. Just read the blooming thing if you're going to read. Erith. Hello, Steve.
Hello, Nick.
Steve.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being there.
I am straight away, when our queen passed... and like you, I'm still not used to hearing King. And every time I hear that word, I picture Elvis.
Right.
And when you said about the...
Or Kong.
Funnily enough, that doesn't spring to mind.
If it does me. I just saw that film again. I liked it. It's pretty good. King Kong.
I like the old original black and white one.
Oh, come off it. That was rubbish. What are you talking about?
I know, I'm a bit like that. Right. Old things and... So, but yeah, when you said about the king, and then you said about the sparkly crown,
the sparkly hat. Yeah, that's the.
Yeah,
that's,
and then you're
why is he wearing?
Who,
why is he wearing the queen's hat? Was my initial response.
But also then you started asking who's going to be performing songs and on stage.
Yeah,
and,
do you know?
And the pictures in my head were getting worse. With obviously, I nearly called him Prince Charles then. But.
Yeah.
King Charles in his jumpsuit, jumping around, singing. But, sorry, that was what I called in for.
Oh, I hope not. It's got to be better than that.
Stuff.
Yes.
Did you hear about the I think it was somewhere down west, about the potholed road that they turned into a crazy golf course? They did, and
where?
And
west. What west?
Yeah, Wiltshire or Devon or somewhere along that.
Yeah,
way,
Wiltshire, Devon, one of those places down there west. Yeah.
And their game got interrupted because a car scraped its exhaust.
Right.
It is true. It was yesterday or the day before.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll look that up, Steve.
Okay. I hope you get well soon as well.
Right, thanks a lot, Steve. Cheers, mate. Let's have a call in Bromley. Hello, Joe.
Hello, mate.
Joe.
Kim Jong-un. I'd like to talk about him for a moment here.
Who?
He's launched... Kim Jong-un, you know, North Korea. He's launched his biggest missile ever. Biggest missile ever. He's so proud of his biggest missile ever.
Biggest missile ever. Yeah.
Biggest business. What kind of world are we living in? So this boy is so proud. His people are starving.
Mm-hmm.
They've got no food.
Yeah.
But I tell you what, isn't he good? He's got the biggest missile ever.
By the last poll that was taken in North Korea, Kim Jong-un is the most popular leader who has ever lived.
What is your impression of it? Do you think it's right? I don't think it's right at all. I think it's ridiculous. The man is insane. The man is insane. He's taunting.
Yeah.
He's vilifying.
Right.
He's doing all the wrong things in the world.
And yet, so successful. His people love him.
He's almost... He must be a Tory.
That's the only explanation you can find. Right. Okay, thanks a lot, Joe. I had no idea. Kim Jong-un's a Tory. Can you believe that?
My name's Dominic Raab, and I'm a Tory.
His name is Dominic Raab, and he's North Korean too. Which is a big news story.
A major capital letters, big news story.
He's probably North Korean as well. Bodge?
I can't comment on that.
He's not going to comment on that. So let's assume the worst. Is he in jail yet, by the way? No? Have they come to a decision? No decision yet, eh?
On Bodge?
Yeah.
No.
No, I would have heard about that. Yeah, this, we're still waiting. Lewisham. Hello, Jane.
Hello, Nick.
Hello, Jane.
You're not making me very happy.
What is that,
these
then?
Things that
not
are happening.
H-A-P-P-Y, and it's over at your place. A lack of it.
We knew that Bodge was going to bodge it, but not this bad.
Wait. What do you mean, not this bad?
Oh, it's terrible, terrible.
What is?
Anyway, I've got an idea. We have to vote for the suffragettes. We just must vote.
Yes.
We just must, right?
Vote for the suffragettes.
What about this coming election, we vote for the Reform Party?
No. Any further questions? No. Epsom. Hello, Angela.
Oh, hello, Nick. I've got a slightly different point of view. I quite like having a head of state, call them a king or a queen or whatever. When the late queen died, we immediately had another head of state. There was no faffing about with elections and all the electioneering, which again would be quite costly. And also, the king did set up the Prince's Trust, which I think helped a lot of young people with enterprise. The late Duke of Edinburgh had the Duke of Edinburgh Award, which helped a lot of young people too.
Mm-hmm.
And as for Oliver Dowden, I mean, doesn't he know that he could just send each council a stamp with the King's head on and they could copy it and put it on the wall?
It had occurred to me, if they want a portrait of the monarch, then a stamp would certainly be the cheapest way of getting it. It would be a very small one. I mean, it would come
with
its own... I guess they could.
I don't know how technology works, but presumably they could enlarge it and put it on the wall and framed as they wished or as they could afford.
Yeah. But why? What is it then about having a royal family that makes you feel, that sort of comforts you so?
I wouldn't say it comforts me. It's just that it's somebody who can represent everybody in the country.
But can he, though? I mean, he has absolutely no experience of normal life. He has got no clue what our lives are like.
But we have no real clue what he is like either.
Of course,
We only know what is presented to us by, all right, the Palace Press Office and the media.
I agree.
Who?
But we don't represent... absolutely. But we don't represent him. You just said that he represents us.
Yes, but... Well, as a head of state, somebody needs to be head of state. I'd rather have...
Why, though?
Because the politicians have got other things to do. I mean, look at the bunch we've elected.
Well, I know.
Look who's been elected as head of state in Bolsonaro, Trump, Biden. Is that what we want?
But France seems to get by with a president. I mean, most other countries don't have a king or a queen as head of state. And a purely... not purely ceremonial, but a mostly ceremonial role. I mean, his job, essentially, is to go around exchanging small talk with strangers. I mean, it's a bit bizarre. Well, it pays really well, but it's just a bit odd.
poor man, what a life. It's not one he's chosen for himself. You've chosen your job. Most people do. He's had his thrust upon him. I think that's something that's sometimes forgotten.
Well, yes, but if I had a choice between what I do for a living and exchanging small talk with strangers for £20 million a year, then I know which one I'd choose. Brighton. Hello, Anthony.
Hello.
Anthony.
Yes, yes. Your previous caller was talking about the privatisation and how we've been robbed of our,
yeah,
our money.
Mugged.
And, yeah, mugged. I mean, one of the things he did miss out was that a lot of pension companies invest in our, in what would be considered safe, things like water, power and all that. But
I'm not sure that that's actually true. It's a constant things. Refrain that I hear from people defending shareholders. You know,
hang on a minute.
People who have nothing call me in, call me up and say, well, it's a politics of envy and you should, we want to support the wealth creators. Well, they don't create wealth, they just take it from us. And yeah. And shares aren't traditionally bought by pension funds because they're too volatile. And so they tend to buy much more solid and reliable things like bonds, which are, you know, they'll have a certain percentage which is baked in. The families of the super rich is who own shares.
And what I was going to say was that I would say I've grown up in, when we had the me generation from the 1980s, thanks to Mrs. Thatcher, where it was somehow, I'm not thanking her. That's an ironic thing.
Yeah,
not
a thanks
thing.
A lot, Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah, but basically, where it's okay to think of yourself now and who cares about anybody else. Basically, if the 2008 banking crisis didn't wake people up to the obvious deficits of having free market politics and free market economies just all at the same time,
well, it didn't.
Hasn't woken them up that it doesn't work because it doesn't work.
It didn't. I mean, one of the reasons that people voted Brexit was to reduce red tape. Now, what kind of red tape do you think they have in mind?
I don't know anything.
Oh,
well,
it's the red tape that's holding back the financiers
from screwing us over again.
I totally agree. But there is another side. I voted Remain. I should put that out there to start with. But there is one big benefit to leaving the EU that sort of came across my mind, and it's that we don't have to adhere to the state aid and have to put things out to tender like we did before, because we're not in the EU anymore, so we don't have to obey those particular rules. We're on a different playing field.
How is that a benefit? So if a multinational corporation comes along and they say, well, we want you to build us a factory and we want you to provide all your workforce for free and we don't want to pay tax for the first 10 years, then that would be okay, because that's that's what you're suggesting.
No, let me get to the other half of the argument. The other part of that is that now, when we do put things out to tender, we don't have to consider it the same way as Buzz Aldrin saying, I'm sat on the rocket built by the lowest tender. He was basically sat on a giant firework by the lowest tender.
Mm.
Now, we don't have to consider that anymore, because what we can do instead is go, actually, we're not going to necessarily go for the cheapest one. We want the best one.
Right, you really think that's how this government organises its affairs? All right, okay.
No, I'm not talking about this government, obviously, because this government's a pile of dog poo.
Sit on the fence, Anthony.
No, unfortunately, I spent virtually all bar my first three years of my life, unless Royal Tunbridge Wells was a Conservative seat in the late 1970s, I've basically lived in a Tory-safe seat for 45 years.
Yeah.
So it's pointless me trying to vote for anybody else.
Of course it isn't. Stop saying that.
Well, what's the point of me voting for every other...
offer this now.
Anthony, if there's 5,000 other people like you where you live, and there must be, then of course it's worth you voting for somebody else. If you don't want a particular party to get in, then vote tactically for whichever party is most likely to challenge them.
Every other party doesn't even get their deposit.
That's
back
because
where
people like you say things like that.
If 5,000 people were to not vote Tory in my constituency and vote somebody else, it would still be Tory.
All right, so 10,000, so 20,000. Doesn't make any difference. Stop being so defeatist. You have to vote. You absolutely must do it. Stop saying you're not going to do it, because even if on the day you think, oh, well, all right, I'll do my duty and I'll go, other people that will have heard you, you're going on in that morose fashion, will think, oh, well, that bloke on the radio said there's no point, so there's probably no point, I'm not going to bother. And if 20,000 people think like that, then we're going to be stuck forever under the same regime.
Well, Brighton isn't my constituency. I live 10 miles away from Brighton.
Right.
But, no, what I said to your guy before he came on was that we've been concentrating so much on growth, 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 money, 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 that we've missed the biggest thing that we should be doing, which is instead of thinking of how much money, how much growth we're trying to put into the economy, which is just going to widen the poverty gap and the gap between the super rich and the rest of us, we should be thinking more about quality of life.
Distribution, yes.
Yeah, it should be, well, we could do this and it would mean we'll get 5-10% growth, but who's that actually going to benefit? Because this is the thing the Tories keep on saying, and this is the big, I would say, not lie, but misrepresentation, that somehow growth is great for all of us, because it's not.
Of course
growth
it isn't.
Is not great
people's
for all of
wages have not increased since about the 1970s. They've flatlined. All of that effort that you put in, you got nothing. All of the wealth that you created, you did not share in. It went to the vanishingly few number of people at the very, very top of the pile. And there is the evidence for that is all around.
I seem to think that linking growth and I would call extreme capitalism, which is what we have in this country and we have had for the last 40 years, I would say if you don't have those, then you're not a proper democracy or something, or it's just rubbish. I'm sorry, but we should be thinking more about
happiness.
People, exactly. Because how far down the ladder have we fallen now? To Gill and some of those other countries that we would consider developing countries, developing economies, are going to get more growth than us.
Well, we're the only country in the G20 that's actually got negative growth this year. Even Russia is doing better than us, if you can believe that. And, it probably has nothing to do with Brexit, except that it has everything to do with Brexit. Because it's the only thing that differentiates us from all of those other countries. We all went through COVID.
Yeah. Do you see that thing about the Orient Express?
Yes.
They're not even going to bother.
Yeah, I know.
We're
open for business. Except we've closed ourselves off from the world, and we might as well build a wall. Anthony, I've got to go, but thanks a lot, mate. Cheer up and vote. Just do it. Let's have Dartford, Francis.
Good morning, Nicholas dear. How are you?
I'm great, mate.
Good. Great to speak to you again. I love you on a Friday night.
Thanks.
Don't like you so much on the Saturday and Sunday, because you're more serious.
Well, not Saturday. No, Saturday's the same as Friday.
No, it's not. You're more light minded on a Friday night.
Trust me, Francis.
You can laugh more.
Saturday is the same as Friday. Sunday is the serious show.
Well, you're not the same on a Friday as you are on a Saturday, to me, anyway.
I'm the same on Saturday as I am on Friday. I think you'll find that that's a fact. Yeah, same show, Friday and Saturday. It's exactly the same show, but just shuffled, and I make it,
But you're different.
In a different order.
I think so. Yeah, you laugh. I laugh more on a Friday than I do on a Saturday.
Well, that's you, Francis. That you're just tickled more by a Friday. That's all.
What do you think of American politics compared to British politics?
I think we're going that way.
Who we are in England are going the way America is?
Britain, yes.
Britain. I could probably agree with you there.
Right.
Those two brothers from another mother.
Brothers from another mother.
Yeah.
Who's a brother from another mother?
Mr. Johnston.
Oh.
And
Wait.
Oh, I see what you're saying. It's right.
Listen to this.
Two peas in a pod. That's what you're saying. Got it.
Two peas in a pod. They yes. are like brothers from another mother.
Brothers from another mother. Got it.
What do you think of this?
What?
Let me play it for you. Hold on.
No, hang on
if
a minute.
If I can get it.
Hang on a minute. What is it before you play it?
It's him, Trump.
It's him, Trump, doing what?
No mask, everything. You can do all you want, but you know, you still need help from the boss.
Is that a record?
No.
Okay, Francis, stop playing it.
It's all right.
Stop playing it. Stop playing it. She just cannot stop playing it. Okay, I don't know where that, what that was or where it was going, but, you know, every now and again, Donald Trump does say something that is unbroadcastable.
Disgusting.
And I can't broadcast it. So thanks, for Francis, for, you know, whatever that was. Bagshot. Charles.
Oh, hello. I'm afraid I'm going to have to disagree a few times with your last caller. Look, I certainly think things like the Royal Estate should be sold off and provide for social housing, because we've got a housing crisis here. I think it's repugnant that we've got acres and acres and acres of unused land. While people can't even get a place or roof over their head. But that aside, looking at the cost of this thing, I don't begrudge the cost of that. I mean, it's compared to what we've wasted money on. I mean, we spent billions on an NHS track and trace system, which was basically an Excel spreadsheet where they screwed up the lost patient details because someone didn't know how to do cut and paste.
Yeah.
We've spent billions upon billions making housing even more unaffordable with these stupid schemes.
What schemes is it that you're talking about?
Oh, you know, the help to buy, well, they call them the help to buy and right. 90% mortgage, all that, which just inflates the price up even more.
Well, it's a help to the developers, is what it is.
Oh, absolutely. And what your previous caller said about the inheritance. Now, my understanding is, if you inherit a place, if you then make that your main residence, you don't have to pay tax until you sell it.
Yeah, but it's not the residence that's the bulk of the fortune.
It's all his money
it's all the cash. It was the Queen's private wealth, which was the jewellery and the paintings and the private homes and the cash in banks.
Yeah. I mean, that's wrong. I do think they should pay some inheritance. Definitely they should pay that.
I mean, the reason why it's been suggested that they don't, I mean, the excuse that they give is that they don't want to dissipate the fortune of the royal family, because that is part of its magnificence, you know.
Well, I mean, he's making billions every year from...
Well, he's making tens of millions. I don't know about billions.
He's making a few. Yeah.
He's going to be just fine.
But no, I'm looking forward to the day. I'm going to buy myself a Union Jack suit. you should come along. We're having a wonderful street party in Bagshot.
I'm definitely not going along.
Are you washing your hair that
to
day?
Anywhere that's got men in Union Jack suits. No, that's a big no from me, Charles, but thanks for the offer. Harrow, Jonathan, in Harrow.
Yeah, hello, Nick, hi.
Yes, Jonathan.
You got a good vibe going on the show. I don't want to destroy it.
I've got a good vibe going on.
Groovy.
You betcha.
But I had a few controversial points to make.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
So when I was talking to your new boy, Before that, I listened to your news where they said that Rishi is going to stop these new highways.
Who?
Rishi Sunak is stopping the
Fishy
new
Sunak,
highway.
Yes. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I think it's because the kiddies in this country are doing all of the subjects like the sociology, the gender studies, talking about their pronouns. They're not doing the engineering. So we do not have the engineers and the people who are needed to do the highway. That was point one.
Wait a minute. What is doing the wokey-cokey got to do with the highways?
because they're not doing, you know, you need to always hire the neighbor. Wait a minute, the neighbor's knocking again. Wait a minute. The problem is, wait a minute. The problem is, if you're not doing the proper...
Don't upset the neighbours. Shh.
Yeah, it's quite big. The problem is, if you're not doing the proper... listen to the proper mathematical subject. They want to do the easy subject, like the feminist studies, the gender studies. I'm not an anti-woman.
Studying what's on TV tonight. Those kind of subjects, yeah.
Yeah, this is... I'm not anti-woman. But the point is, they're not doing the engineering. they're not doing the engineering, the mathematics, and all of
nothing.
Things.
Nothing good could ever come from a sentence that starts, "I'm not anti-woman, but."
And I have a few other points quickly, if I can.
Oh no. Did he say that?
Possibly.
The accent's so strong. And it was so surprising that he would say that, because I've spoken to him before, that I didn't catch it the first time, but I suspect that because we've got 8 seconds, and the moment that he said it, my mind went,
"Warning, warning!"
Did he actually say that? But then he said it again, and at that point I thought, okay, I really actually did hear that, and then I got rid of him. So, if... the first one got out, then I apologize.
I am very sorry that I screwed up. Totally screwed. I mean, I am so sorry. You just don't know how sorry I am. I am sorry.
Yeah, but it wasn't my fault. This show was like this when I got here. Let's see, what are we going to get now? Let's go for Notting Hill. Hello, Ash.
Hello.
Ash.
Yes, am I going to be the last for tonight?
I don't know. Let's find out.
Okay, yes, I always listen to your show.
Thanks.
It's late. Not just because I found it funny, first of all, but I found you very intelligent. Believe me or not.
Okay, not.
No, as in, I get really serious points from your words, even when you play funny stuff.
Right.
But anyway, manipulation of the news. This stuff we say is just like it. We got nothing to entertain each other. And then we just talk about this stuff. You got to see Iran in Europe, you know, revolutions happening. How many played this stuff? Russia.
I can't really understand what it is you're saying, Ash. I'm not really following what you're saying.
I'm saying.
Are you driving right now?
No. I was sitting in the car.
Okay, then.
6 minutes waiting for you.
Right.
And then I just got out, and then you just called me. I didn't want to miss opportunity. But, you know, it's just like when we talk about a manipulation of media or government, this is just like a game of, you know, just like a little, I don't know. It's not serious. The serious stuff is going on somewhere, and even affecting the U.S. media is like, for example, I'll just give you an example there was 1,500 recorded people being arrested in Iran.
Okay, Ash, you know, whatever it is that you called up to tell us, this is not the time. You can't introduce a topic like people getting arrested in Iran or wherever it is that you're talking about at 3 minutes to the end of the show. Can't do it. God, we were going along just fine before that bloke decided to swear his face off received with much surprise. And then this entire show has been sort of tripping, falling towards the end. I blame you.
There's nothing to do with me.
Guilty.
What's good for you, then you know what you can do.